صل على محمد وآل محمد. رحم الله من يقرأ الفاتحة. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله. صلى الله وسلم عليك يا رسول الله وعلى أهل بيتك المعصومين المنتجبين. يا ليتنا كنا سادتي فنفوز فوزا عظيما. السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله. السلام عليك يا ابن رسول الله. السلام عليك يا ابن أمير المؤمنين. السلام عليك يا ابن فاطمة المظلومة. ما خاب من تمسك بكم وأمن من لجأ إليكم. يا ليتنا كنا معكم سادتي فنفوز والله فوزا عظيما. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. آمنا بالله صدق الله العلي العظيم. صلوات اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. For the love of Abba Abdullah al-Hussein, with the loudest of our voices, صلوا على محمد وآل محمد. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعجل فرجه. For the love of Abul Fadl al-Abbas, with the loudest of our voices, صلوا على محمد وآل محمد. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. And for the purification of our hearts and the hastening of the reappearance of our beloved awaited savior Abu Salih al-Mahdi, with the loudest of our voices, صلوا على محمد وآل محمد. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعجل فرجه. السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. Once again, we thank Almighty Allah تبارك وتعالى for giving us this wonderful night, wonderful moment, to continue seeking his nearness through the values established and taught by our beloved master and savior Abu Abdullah al-Hussein on the plains of Karbala. Mu'minin and mu'minat, you recall very well last night we discussed purposeful personality and we looked at ways and means of becoming a person of purpose. So someone asked me a question last night after the majlis. You mentioned of insights as one of the focus of purposeful personality. What do you mean by insights or foresightedness? It simply means wuduhul hadaf, having clear aim and objective in life. In other words, it is to know where you were, where you are, and where you are heading towards to. And this is beautifully highlighted and explained by our beloved master, Imam Amirul Mu'mineen, salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Rahimallahu abdan arifa min aina wa fi aina wa ila ain. Amirul Mu'mineen alayhi salam said, may the blessings and peace of Allah be upon any servant who knows where he was, where he is, and where he's heading towards to. So when we talk of insight or foresightedness, it is to know where you were. You were in a state of non-existence, and Allah, out of his mercy, provided you with his existence. You need to appreciate and recognize that. Now you are in a state of existence, but you need apparatus, you need means to thrive and to keep going. And it is only Allah who is capable and powerful of providing these provisions for you to thrive and to ensure that your life goes accordingly. And then where are we heading to? The same thing, we are heading to Allah, Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, and we will need his mercy on that day. Now for tonight, the verse I've just quoted is Quran 3, verse 102, Surah Ali Imran. Kindly mu'mineen and mu'minat, as we mentioned last night, pay attention to these verses. These are very powerful verses that when we reflect upon them, we should realize that it relates to us and it will help us to reform and to become better human beings and better lovers and followers of Ahlul Bayt as wished by Abu Abdullah al-Husayn alayhi salam. The verse, mu'mineen and mu'minat, highlights on the importance of religious identity. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu taqullah haqqa tuqati wa la tamutunna illa wa antum muslimun. O you who believe, fear Allah the way it should be feared, and do not die except as Muslim, except as someone who submit wholeheartedly to the command of Allah. Now, departing from this beautiful verse, our topic of tonight is identity struggles. It is a struggle that all of us go through in our lives. Sometimes we tend to ask ourselves questions. Are we Muslims? Are we Shias or not? Who are we? So it's of great importance on a night like tonight to understand what an identity is all about from the Islamic perspective. Our examination of tonight will be of the following stages. First stage, we'll look at the essence or the definition of an identity. Then we'll look at, on the second stage, the components or the compositions of an identity. We'll then go forward to look at different forms of identity. Again, we'll continue by looking at our needs for identity. Do I really need identity, or I do not need an identity? Why are we talking of an identity? Is it important or it's not important? And then we'll look at the clashes between religious identity and Western identity. The struggles that we go through between these two major identities. And then the last stage of the examination is to share some practical tips on how to navigate through. As you go through these challenges, can I be proud of a Muslim and uphold Islamic principles? Or no, there are areas or places when I'm there, I should not do that. So we go through that struggle. How do we navigate through? So kindly mu'mineen and mu'minat, pay attention. Let us look at this very important topic on this beautiful night of Alamdar, Kamar Bani Hashim, Abbas, alayhi afdalu salatu wa aska salam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ala Muhammad. What is an identity? Hawiyat, in Urdu, in Farsi, in Arabic, hawiya. Mu'minin and mu'minat, identity simply means when people share something in common which makes them unique and differentiate them from others. That's what identity is all about. Typical example. Matam. Or Sinezani. Or Latmiya. It is our identity. As lovers and followers of Aba Abdullah. Yes, it may not be wajib. But you will not come across any group on the face of the universe who passionately and emotionally beat their chests on account of knowing the truth that Aba Abdullah stood for in Karbala. So it's an example of an identity. When I beat my chest, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Abbas, Ya Abbas, Ya Abbas, what am I saying? What am I indicating to? I'm saying that Ya Aba Abdullah, Ya Abbas, my chest is sacrificed for you. I'm saying that Ya Aba Abdullah, if I were in Karbala, I would have given my chest to you. So an identity is what makes you unique. That's an example of an identity. I'm told, I stand to be corrected, that Canadians, they like saying I'm sorry, even if they are right. Barabar. So if that is true, that can be an identity for Canadians. Even if they are right, they said, I'm sorry. So something you share in common and makes you stand out there, that is an identity. Now, look at the components or the compositions of an identity. Kindly pay attention, mu'min and mu'minat. The first composition of an identity is land. Zameen, ardh. What do I mean by land? A place where you were born, where your grandparents or grandfathers, you like, were born. One way or the other, you are connected to that place. Alhamdulillah, most of you here, if not all, live in this city or live in this country. This is the source of your sustenance. This is the source of your livelihood. To this land is a component of your identity. Second composition of an identity is language. Language is crucial. Today you find some of our sons and daughters will tell us, no, I'm an English person, I'm not a Gujarati person. Huh? Some will say, no, I'm an English person, I'm not an Urdu-speaking person. Born and raised here, born and bred here. But yes, your grandparents were from somewhere else. So directly or indirectly, you are related. There is a link. So language is of great importance. You find this group, they speak this particular language, and that makes them unique compared to the other group. Third composition of an identity is heritage. Turaf. We all have our heritages, isn't it? You've got your culture. You've got your norms. You know, when you have marriages within our Khoja, when you do a Mendi or what, Mark, what Mendi or... So this can be a culture which cannot be found in other cultures. So that can be a composition of an identity. The way you conduct your marriages, the way you conduct your naming ceremonies, it's a composition of identity, heritage. Typical example, you go to Iraq, Babylon is their identity, it's a heritage. So it's a composition of identity. You go to Egypt, for instance, they are proud of the history of Pharaoh, isn't it? It's a composition of an identity. The last composition of an identity is religion. Religion. Christian, Jewish, Muslim. Your religion is part and parcel of your identity. And Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala in Quran 42 verse 13 discusses this. شَرَعَ لَكُم مِّنَ الدِّينِ مَا وَصَّى بِهِ نُوحًا وَالَّذِي أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكِ وَمَا وَصَّيْنَا بِهِ إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَمُوسَى وَعِيسَى أَنْ أَقِيمُوا الدِّينَ وَلَا تَتَفَرَّقُوا. All the verses, inshallah, will appear on the screen. Allah ordained for you religion. Or he ordains religion upon Nuh alayhi salam. And the same thing he ordained to Ibrahim, Musa, and Isa. And Akimu Dina, to stand firm for the religion. And they should not be divided. So religion is a composition of an identity. Now scholars, when they look at these compositions, they concluded that we have the following forms of an identity. First identity is national identity. You are a Canadian. It's an identity for you. That's your nationality. National identity. Hawiya watani they call. You are British. That's your national identity. You Pakistani. That's your national identity. There's a tradition, you know, from the Holy Prophet. Although mystics have different way of looking at that tradition. Hubbul watani min al iman. Love of one's nation is part of iman. So the first type of identity is national identity. Second form of an identity is tribal identity. You are Khoja, you are not Iranian. So being Khoja is an identity. Being Iranian is an identity. Being a Pakistani is an identity. I'm talking of that your culture and what your culture is known for. That you as this particular group do and uphold is your identity. The other form of identity is Western identity. From the liberalist perspective. Today, it doesn't matter whether you live in the West or not. In fact, I came across people who are not living in the West, and they uphold Western identity more than those who live in the West. At the end of the day, the capitalists are managing and controlling the world. So therefore, Western components or traces can be found everywhere in the world. So you have Western identity. The last form of an identity is what? Religious identity. You, Habibi, you are Pakistani, Muslim, Canadian, Shia Ithna Ashari. That's your identity. Each one of these are of great importance. And Quran mentions it, isn't it? Quran 49, verse 13. Ya ayyuhan nas inna khalaqnakum min dhakarin wa untha. We created you of males and females. Wa ja'alnakum shu'uban wa qaba'ila. We made you tribes and nations, tribal identity, national identity. Lita'arafu. But look at the last part of the verse. Inna akramakum indallahi atqakum. That is a religious identity. Now, do we need identity or not? Someone will say, why are you talking about this really? Is it important? Do I need to be proud of who I am or not? Very important. It's crucial. And there are reasons as to why we need identity, mu'minin and mu'minat. The first reason is that an identity provides us with an opportunity and platform to express ourselves. Kindly pay attention, mu'minin and mu'minat. You will hear people who say, look, I live in the West. I have freedom to express myself. I have freedom. Nare Haidari. Some places you can't do it. So I'm proud of where I am, because it provided me with that platform to express my emotions. You can't do it somewhere else. You'll be arrested. So number one, we need an identity and to be proud of who we are, because it gives us the opportunity to express ourselves. Another example, you see this community, ISIJ, JCC, it is our identity. When I come here, I get the platform to express myself. Just now, Muhammad Abbas Karim recited beautifully. He can't reside somewhere else in the same city, but here, because it is his identity and he is comfortable to recite and demonstrate and showcase his identity. Number two reason as to why we need identity is what? Identity gives us social recognition. When people recite, they say, wow, 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 wow. Social recognition. Oh no, out there in the field of your expertise, work, you do something and you excel in it, you are recognized. Whereas you may do the same thing somewhere and you'll not be recognized. So identity gives us that social recognition. Number three, mu'minin and mu'minat, which is the most important reason as to why we must be proud of our identity, is that it gives us that sense of belonging. I belong here. This is where I belong to. And I can be proud of calling this place my home. Calling this place that I belong to. You look at millions of people, for example, who go to Karbala on the day of Arba'een. Look at that feeling of sense of belonging when people embark on that safar of ishq to Aba Abdullah al-Husayn alayhi salam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Ya Ali, it gives us sense of belonging. I belong here. I can wear black, come and sit here. This is my home, this is my identity. Aside Islamic examples, you're a Canadian, you go somewhere, you feel proud, I belong here. But you know, Islam is very clear. Be proud of your identity, but not at the expense of others' identity. Don't undermine others. Do not ridicule others. Be proud of who you are. It's of great importance. But Quran makes it very clear, 49:11. La yaskhar qawmun min qawm. Asa an yakunu khayran minhum. Wala nisa'un min nisa'in. Asa an yakunna khayran minhum. Wala talmizu anfusakum. ولا تنابزوا بالألقاب بئس الاسم الفسوق بعد الإيمان ومن لم يتب فأولئك هم الظالمون. Do not mock others. Do not undermine others. Be proud of being Shia. Not just Shia, be proud of being Shia Ithna Ashari. Be proud of being Ma'tami. If he's not doing, don't worry about him, you do it. Be proud of who you are. And hence, it's of great importance as we go about being proud of our identity
to pause a little bit to do the following. Number one, try to identify and recognize your identities. Because each and every individual is of multiple identities. Sit somewhere, ask yourselves, what are my identities? Identify those identities. Number two, mu'minin and mu'minat, after identifying those identities, pay attention to those identities. You don't want to become half-cooked, half-baked Shia, if not Ashari. You want to become true, true Shia, if not Ashari. You want to become crazy and madly in love with Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. That's what Jesus' identity. At the same time, Islam says, identify that you are a Canadian and be proud of that identity. Identify that I'm Pakistani, I'm Khoja. Be proud of that identity. But the bottom line, that is not a boarding pass to undermine and ridicule others. That's not a boarding pass to sow the seed of divisions. But be proud of who you are. The way you respect others, you expect them to respect you when you go out there to show that I'm proud of my identity. Now, clashes between identities. And most especially, between religious identity and Western liberal identity. I'm going to give you some practical examples. And then towards the end, will suggest practical ways to navigate through. Kindly pay attention, mu'minin and mu'minat. Especially our youth. There are differences between our religious identity and our Western identity. And these differences are on three levels. The first level is ideological. Some of the Islamic ideologies are completely different from the Western ideologies. And the earlier we recognize that, the better for all of us. On the ideological side, I would like to give three examples. The first example, you see, when you look at the Western ideology or the liberalist mind, Mehware Zindigi. Mehware Zindigi, Mehware Hayat. Central to life, from the Western perspective, is insan. Human being. But from the Islamic perspective, central to life is God. It's God. Insan is Khalifatullah. Inni ja'ilun fil ardi khalifa. Quran 2 verse 30. So therefore, this is the first difference on ideology. Second difference on ideology is freedom. There is freedom in Islam, Habibi. There is freedom in Tashayyu. And of course, we also have our Western freedom. We are free. But obviously, we all know whether Western freedom or religious freedom, there is no absolute freedom. But there are clashes between these two civilizations, if you like, or identities. Typical example, in the West, you accumulate your money, go work hard, legally or lawfully so, and make the money. You are free to give charity, you are free not to give. No big deal. No law in the Western society will impose on you to donate. But Islam is different. You look at Quran 3, verse 92. لَن تَنَالُوا الْبِرَّ حَتَّى تُنْفِقُوا مِمَّا أَحْسَنْتُمْ. You will not get righteousness until you give what you love the most. So Habibi Amin stood here earlier on, said donate, donate, donate. Baba, it's wajib to donate. حتى تنفقوا مما تحبون. So from the Islamic perspective, when you are given by Allah, it becomes wajib on you to give out. It's a difference. But these are very light or lighter differences on ideology. Third example on ideology is what? From the Western perspective, you need to take care of two things: mental health and physical health. But from the religious perspective, you need to take care of three things: mental health, physical health, and spiritual health. Differences. So that's on ideology. Now come the second level on behavior. Behavior here, don't take it on face value. Take a technical meaning there, not literal meaning. First example, in the Western society, you're free to shake anybody's hand. No Muharram, Muharram, no big deal. You hug, come to your time, abadu barabar. You hug, TK, TK. You hug. In the Western society, Mark is like that, isn't it, Habibi? But Islam said, no. No, Sheikh, you know, my heart is okay. I don't feel anything, even if I shake. Islam said, Habibi, no. Because Islam is not looking at you. Islam is looking at all of us. If it is only you, no big deal, Habibi. You, no big deal. You are mu'min, malaika. But Islam is not looking at you alone. There may be one in that corner. He may be struggling because of him. Islam says, no, all. So on the behavioral level, in the West, I can shake. At work, I shake a hand, I hug. But Islam says no. Another example on the same length, mixed gathering. Islam allows mixed gathering based on certain principles. But in the Western world, mixed gathering with music, boom, 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 boom. It's allowed. It's not unlawful. Islam says when you do your marriages, make it Islamic. When you do your reception, make it Islamic. Recite Mankabat, Ali Ke Chani Wale, Hoshiyes Ebanate. Not music. That's Islam. But Western society, no. Harry Kelly, you want to mention Tupac Shakur, these old musicians. That's West. So it's a struggle. Our youth struggle. Our men are struggling. Our women are struggling. I'm at work, Sheikh. And this, my boss, just want to shake my hand, Sheikh. There is nothing. What can I do? And Islam is telling me, don't do. It's a struggle. You go to school on campuses, universities. Your classmate, she comes to you, she shakes your hand, she's no mahram. Do you give the hand, you don't give? Let me give, no problem, otherwise she'll be offended. But Islam says I shouldn't give. Identity crisis, big time. Another example, somebody said, you know, Canada gave me everything. But what has Islam given me? So I'm proud of being a Canadian, but Islam, struggle. Can I say, confidently, I'm a proud Shia Muslim. No, but what has it given me? Struggle. How do you navigate through, Habibi? So this is the second example. Let's go last example, and then we give practical tips, and we're done, inshallah. Third example, Islam call it symbols. Symbolic act of worship. Typical example of symbolic act of worship is Safa and Marwa, Arafat. These are all symbolic act of worship. But don't take them on face value. Hijab. It's a symbolic act of worship. I'm beautiful, man. And my heart is clean, Sheikh. My heart is clean. What's the problem? I just just want to be me. Why your God is so tough on us? I'm praying, sure. But Islam says no. Islam says wear the hijab. But Western world, Western identity says no, you're free. You want to wear fine, you don't want to wear? Up to you. Clash. We get caught up sometimes. No, I don't want to wear. But Islam says wear. How do you do? What do you do? Do you remove the hijab? Or what do you do? A young girl goes to school, uni, youth. She wants to keep the hijab, but her friends are looking at her with certain look. They're laughing at her. Places where Islamophobia is rampant. I can't wear my hijab going there, Sheikh. They'll be screaming at me. They'll be laughing at me. But Islam says, wear the hijab. What do you do? It's a struggle. It's not easy. It's easier said than done. I'm mentioning this, inshallah, to stimulate more discussions and to see what we can do. Another example on the symbols. In the West, it's easy. You can make dog your friend. Ajallakumullah, dog. No big deal. Islam doesn't hate any animal, by the way. In fact, we have a beautiful tradition from Imam Jaffar al-Sadiq, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. Imam said, don't look at animals with a bad look because they praise Allah. Look at that. To such an extent, even Imam Jaffar mentioned, even your clothes, they worship God. They only stop worshiping when they are dirty. He said even walls of your houses worship God. So Islam, respect animals and their rights. But somebody may come and say, Sheikh, I just want dog as my pet. In my house, go to my bed. But Islam says no. What do you do? You know, I went somewhere for majalis. One boy stressed his mother. If you do not buy a dog for me, I will stop praying. Can you believe it? Hassan, can you believe it? Believe it or not, my bro. It's a challenge. It's easier said than done. Maybe his friends, they all have. Why not me? Is this going to take me to Jahannam? Like the people will ask, if I don't wear hijab, Sheikh, am I going to go to Jahannam? I said, no, but Fatima Tuzara wore it. Zainab wore it. And I'm sure you love Zainab and Fatima. Why don't you just follow them? No, it doesn't make sense. It doesn't make, yeah, of kind. But Fatima Tuzara did it. So we have this crisis. Alcohol consumption. In the Western world, we all live in the West. Drink reasonably. It's not unlawful, of course, depending on your age. And the age are not allowed. But drink reasonably and don't drink and drive so that you arrive safely. Some of us get tempted. We go, we drink. I'm not saying it's easy. Some I know they are going through a lot in their lives. But Islam says, don't drink. Don't even sit around a table where liquor is served. Unless if it's totally beyond your control. Okay, I'm at work. I'm the manager there. Most of the employees are not Muslims. Yeah? And December party we throw when we are going for holidays. There must be alcohol there. What do I do? Islam says, don't. What do I do? Struggle. Big time struggle. Drugs, which many countries, not only Islam, don't really sanction people taking drugs. But a Muslim will come, young boys, you know what, Shaykh Allah, stress. Stress to Allah.
What do I do, Sheikh?
Amal not happen. So I take this, I feel cool.
Sallallahu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. What do I do? What do I do? There are ways and means Islam provide us. What? And there are so many of these examples I'm sure you can formulate and think of. Mu'minin and mu'minat. Islam and the teachings of Ahlul Bayt invite us to be proud of our religious identity. Alhamdulillah. Thumma alhamdulillah. We live in a society where we are allowed to practice our faith. This is the greatest ni'mah of Allah. There are places out there, they cannot go there and do Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya. They can't. They have to hide and do it. It is the greatest ni'mah of Allah that I can call Ya Ali, Ya Ali, Ya Ali, where I am living in. Let us, for a second, think of the importance of being proud of our religious identity. So Islam, on the first level, encourage us to try as much as we can to be proud of our religious identity. Be proud of being a Muslim. Nothing to shy about. Nothing to be ashamed of. Be proud of being true lover and follower of Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen. Salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi. Ya Ali. Nothing to be ashamed of. If things are not clear, could be hijab, could be alcohol, could be music during your wedding receptions, could be dancing, you name them, go on and go on and go on. Islam doesn't expect you to become an angel overnight. But Islam says, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Ask those who know if you do not know. You've got scholars in the community. You've got opinion leaders in the community. Engage them. Discuss with them. What Islam doesn't want is what? You know you are doing wrong and you go out there being proud of it. I know it's wrong, but I'm humble about it. So look at these practical tips. Number one, mu'minin and mu'minat, respect and be proud of your religious identity. Our laws in the UK, our laws in Canada, our laws in the United States, our laws in Australia, you name them, provide us with the freedom to practice our faith. Yes, we have challenges, I agree. But we should not hide behind these challenges not to practice and be proud of our religion. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Munafiqun, verse number 8, he said, وَلِلَّهِ الْعِزَّةُ وَلِرَسُولِهِ وَلِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. The honor is for Allah, His messenger, and the believers. So be proud of who you are, mu'minin and mu'minat. Be proud of being lover of Ali alayhi salam. Be proud of that. That's number one. Quran makes it very clear. Inna deena inda Allahi al-Islam. Quran 3 verse 19. Religion to Allah is Islam, is to submit to Allah. Look at the companions of Ahlul Bayt. How proud they were. Tonight is the night of Abbas. Look at how Abbas proud he was in Karbala.
Abbas was thirsty. Sakina was thirsty. Umm Kulthum was thirsty. Asghar was thirsty. Abbas got the water. Jurisprudentially, he could have drunk and there was nothing wrong and no blame on Abbas. But Abbas looked at the water. He said, Ya nafsi min ba'dil Husayni huni. That's being proud of who you are. Being proud of your wilaya for Ahlul Bayt alayhimu salatu wassalam. Abbas said, Wallah, I will not drink from this cold water because I know my master is going to be fed from the syrup of death. Look at Maysam al-Tamar. They placed knife on his tongue because he was talking Ali, 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 Ali. So the enemies placed knife on his tongue and they said to him, talk Ali again, we will cut your tongue. They removed the knife waiting for him. He said, Ala uhadithukum an habibi amir al-mu'mineen. Can I tell you more about my beloved amir al-mu'mineen Ali? That's what he said. They brought his sons and they were going to behead him. Maitham, isn't it? They asked him, what are your final words? He said, kill my sons first before me. Hey, they asked him why. He said, because I want them to love with the love of Ali. Being proud of your religious identity. Don't lose it. I know it's a big challenge. We all live in this part of the world. It is not easy. I do a lot of interfaith and intrafaith. I even get involved sometimes in political issues. It is not easy. But wallah, when you stand tall and show that you are proud of who you are, you are proud of your hijab, you are proud of your Husayni, 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 you are proud of your gamba, gamba, gamba bayan, they respect you. But when they realize that you undermine who you are, they tend to disrespect you. Companions of Ahlul Bayt. Look at the mother of Wahabul Kalbi. They beheaded Wahab. They took the head of Wahab and threw the head to the mother. The mother looked at the head. She lifted the head, said, Ya Allah, if you give me 20 of this head, I will give it back to Hussein. Be proud of who you are, mu'minin and mu'mina. We have opportunities in this part of the world to represent Islam and tashayyu beautifully. Don't miss these opportunities. But bottom line, be law-abiding citizens, be law-abiding residents, and be proud of who you are. No one will stop you from being proud of who you are. We saw immigrants becoming ministers of states. You can also be proud of being the lover of Ali. Look at Habib ibn Mawahir al-Asadi and Muslim ibn Awsaja. They met in Kufa and they were only discussing how to demonstrate their wilaya to Aba Abdullah. Be proud of who you are. That's number one. Number two. Wherever you may be, at work, at school, at uni, note that you are representing Islam. You are an ambassador of tashayyu, an ambassador of Islam. You don't have to be always like them. Nobody's paying your tax. You don't have to please them. Please your heart, Allah and Ahlul Bayt. Look at Sayyidah Zainab. In the court of the enemy in Sham, she demonstrated, I'm proud of this hijab. I don't believe a headscarf was removed. I believe face veil was removed. Because if they had to remove that head one, Allah will protect the hair of Zainab. So at work, be proud of who you are. Quran 9, verse 71 mentions this. والمؤمنون والمؤمنات بعضهم أولياء بعض يأمرون بالمعروف وينهون عن المنكر. I mentioned last night, you are an accountant working in a firm, be the best accountant in that firm. You as a lover of Imam Jaffar, you cannot be the lowest employee there. That's what Imam Jaffar expects from you. You are the manager at that bank, among the managers, be the top one. You are a university student, a Shi'i, Imam Jaffar wants you to be the highlight there. But be a good Muslim and be proud of your Islamic identity. We saw a lot of hijabis who are taking big positions in the world today. In business world, in political world, I'm just taking time. Business world, political world. They are there. So that's number two. You are representing Islam, and so be that true Muslim there. And last but not least, instill that in your children from young age. Otherwise, you'll regret it. You will regret it. The first teacher for children are their parents. If parents are not serious, children are going to grow not being serious. Instill that religious identity in them. Home, mosque. Home, mosque. And when they come mosque, let them be children. Let them be. No place for them to go than mosque. Because they represent Ali ibn al-Asghar alayhi salam. Instill those values in them. But if you, as fathers and mothers, if I say you, I'm not referring to you, I'm just talking. It's a figure of speech. Not proud of who you are as a Shia, then your children will not be proud. There are people today, unfortunately, they even talk ill of matam. You don't do? Fine. Bismillah, go. Nobody forces you to do matam. It's your cup of tea. But me, I will heat the chest until I'm feeling the heat from inside. You don't do? Don't say anything bad about it. Zainab did this. And most especially in front of your children. Instill those values in you, and the children will see it. Tonight is the night of Qamar Banu Hashim. The night of Alamdar. It is the night of Tawassul. Tawassul. Name Abbas. Sewasila. Hehardoha Kelie. It is the night of seeking Allah through Abbas alayhi salam. Isme Azam Eye Mu'min Ke Iltija Kelie. Let's take our heart to Furat in Karbala. Allah will fulfill your hajat tonight through these tears of Abbas alayhi salam. You know, Ummul Baneen gave her sons alive to Hussein. Ummul Baneen gave Abbas alive to Aba Abdullah al-Hussein alayhi salam. What are you giving to Hussein tonight? She gave four sons to Aba Abdullah. What are you giving to Hussein tonight before we go out of this Imam Barga? I think we can give Hussein one thing. In addition to our ma'atam and recitation, we can donate towards the majalis of Aba Abdullah. Because Ummul Baneen would go to Jannat al-Baqiyya. She would collect sand from Jannat al-Baqi. Ummul Baneen
would make 5 domes out of the sand of Jannat al-Baqiyya. She would sit next to these domes, small domes, and she would lament and cry over the tragedy of Karbala. To such an extent, the enemy, core enemy of Ahlul Bayt, Marwan ibn al-Hakam, would cry upon hearing the voice of Ummul Baneen. They came to Ummul Baneen, they asked Ummul Baneen, you lost 4 sons in Karbala, but you made 5 domes. She said, the 5th one is my son, Abu Abdullah. Allahu Akbar. The 5th one is my son, Abu Abdullah. Ummul Baneen, by doing this, she taught us to keep Farsh Aza alive. Keep Farsh Aza alive. She recited majlis in Jannat al-Baqiyya. But you know, Mu'mineen and Mu'mina, Narish mentioned, Imam Zainul Abideen approached Ummul Baneen. He said, oh, Ummul Baneen, we've realized that when Abbas has been mentioned, you do not cry. But for every companion mentioned to you, you cried. Ummul Baneen said, oh, Zainul Abideen, I do not believe my Abbas would let Hussein down. She said, oh, Imam Zain al-Abideen, I believe my Abbas would protect Aba Abdullah al-Husayn. That was the moment Imam Zain al-Abideen began to narrate the masa'ib of Abbas. He said, oh, Umm al-Baneen, we saw uncle came out. He rode the horse. He headed towards the water of Furat. Enemies came, surrounded him. He warded them off. We saw uncle came off the horse. He went to pick up the water. But uncle said, oh my soul, are you going to drink from this cold water when your master will be fed from the syrup of death? He said, oh Umm al-Baneen, uncle did not drink the water. He said, we saw him came back, rode the horse, and he began to head back to Khaymaga. But an enemy appeared from behind. When he appeared from behind, he said, oh, Umm al-Baneen, we saw him strike the right arm of Abbas. He said, Umm al-Baneen, we saw uncle trying to hold the flag with left hand. Can you imagine the right hand is falling down and he's trying to hold the flag with the left hand? He said, oh, Umm al-Baneen, we saw another man appeared from behind. And he struck the left arm of Abbas. You know, one night Ayatollah Naini recited Majlis of Abbas on a night like tonight in Karbala. Ayatollah Naini narrated, he said, I went back home at night. While sleeping, I saw the Lady of Light. But when I saw Fatima al-Zahra, she was crying, she was very sad. He said, I thought I made mistakes in the takarir of the masa'ib of Abbas. So I looked at her, I said, oh, Lady of Light, have I made mistakes in the takarir of the gam of Abbas? She said, no. You reminded me of Abbas when you said to your audience, Fatima al-Zahra is here with you. But she said, oh, Naini, whenever you recite the masa'ib of Abbas, there is a line you should never forget. She said to me, no, what is the line? When someone falls from a horse, especially falling in front, you would expect a person to fall with 2 arms. She said, oh, Naini,
remember this line. When are my Abbas fair? That my Abbas fell without any arm. Then Imam Zain al-Abidin said, "Oh, Umm al-Baneen, we saw Uncle Abbas fell down. When he fell down, they came and surrounded his body. They began to kick him one after the other." He said to her, Umm al-Baneen, "I know you love Hussein and Sukaina. You know who told us Abbas is dying?" Umm al-Baneen said, "No." He said to her, "It was Sukaina." She asked him, "How?" He said, "When Uncle Abbas was in the field, Sukaina was on the shoulder of Sayyida Zainab." All of a sudden, Sukaina called out, "Auntie Zainab, uncle is falling down." But look at this line. It's the most painful line. Zainab asked Sukaina, "Why are you saying uncle is falling down?" She said, "I saw the flag falling down." He called out, "Wa alayka salam ya Aba Abdullah, Aba Abdullah," got to the body of Abbas. But Abbas could not tell whether it was Aba Abdullah. Abbas began to talk. He said, "Please do not hurt me. I want to bid farewell to my master." Aba Abdullah said, "Abbas, don't you recognize Hussein?" They were all saying Hussein, and Hussein was saying Abbas. Aba Abdullah lifted the head of Abbas. He placed it on his lap, isn't it? Then Abbas said to Aba Abdullah, "I'm sorry, I will not be there to protect you." He said, "Oh, my master Hussein, do not tell my mom I left you." He said, "Oh, my master Hussein, I promised Sakina water. Say sorry to Sakina." He said, "Oh, my master Hussein, I will not be there to protect Zainab." I said, "Ya Abbas, I wish you were there when they began to slap on the cheek of Zainab." But look at that final moment. Abbas said to Aba Abdullah, "When I was born, I was able to look at your face. But I'm dying, I cannot see your face." Abbas moved his head from the lap. Aba Abdullah asked him why. He said, "I'm dying and I'm on your lap, but soon you will be facing the enemies." I said, "Abbas, I wish you were there when they began to poke the lips of Aba Abdullah." I said, "Abbas, I wish you were there when the enemy sat on the chest of Aba Abdullah." In conclusion, mu'minin and mu'minat, ajrukum ala Allah. Imam al-Zain al-Abidin, after this, Umm al-Baneen said to him, "I know my Abbas would not leave Hussein, but I did not cry for Abbas because I know there was no one to cry for Hussein." ألا لعنة الله على القوم الظالمين إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون وسيعلم الذين ظلموا آل محمد أي منقلب ينقلبون. It is the night of Abbas. We pray Allah fulfill our legitimate desires. Allah grant us with the ziyara of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas عليه السلام مرضى of مؤمنين and مؤمنات بحق عباس عليه السلام. May Allah cure them, inshallah. We all have our hajat. بحق عباس. May Allah fulfill our hajat. Ya Abbas. Ya Abbas. Ya Hussein.